work?
I mean, I guess personally, I prefer it maybe like a week later, but I don't know what everyone else thinks.
But we're having spring break, right? So I guess we can use that time to prepare.
To prepare? Okay.
Yeah, since we're not, I mean, everything's shut down anyway, so I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think what we are going to do is that to have a test on the, let me see the calendar. It's April 9th. Okay. So that's what is in the syllabus anyway. It's on April 9th. We'll have a test. I'll probably it's a study guide this weekend. Okay.
Professor, is there a way you can do a practice test on web design for this?
I think I already worked out all the logistic issue with the other two classes. I have I have tests for both classes.
All right.
And so logistically it works.
We have class.
Other than it's difficult to stop people from cheating. So I don't know what to do there, but whatever happened. Okay.
Do we have class on Tuesday before the test?
Yeah, we have class on Tuesday.
Okay. I'm sorry, I just came in right now because my thing was weird enough, but you were saying April 9th we have a test on Canvas, is that correct? Is that what you're saying?
Using Web Assign.
Web Assign, okay. And you were saying, what were you saying about, like, notes and stuff like that? What were you saying?
The notes will be open notes and open form.
Oh, okay.
Because I have no way to monitor you guys. Mm. Does everybody has a webcam?
Yes and no, it doesn't really work sometimes.
Okay. Yeah, so it's really impossible for me to monitor.
Yeah. Sometimes those things like will end up like really like making your computer super slow.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so that's what we is over then. Critically then. Of course, the third one is this one. Okay. So we're going to start out with an example for the under them case. Okay. Okay. In this case, we are given x0. Equal to minus 2 x prime 0 equal to 0. Of course, we are still talking about the spring mass system. So you should, so this equation physically means something, right? Okay. So this guy, you guys able to hear me okay?
Yeah, you're good.
So this is initially, the initial position is negative 2. That means it's 2 units above the equilibrium position, okay? Because negative is up here. So what happened on this? How do I do this? Auxiliary equation is this. So you cannot factorize it. Discriminant is actually negative. So m will be minus 2 plus or minus square root 2 square minus 4 times 10 divided by 2. And this is going to be equal to what? Minus 2 plus or minus square root negative 36 over 2 minus 2 plus or minus 6i divided by 2 minus 1 plus or minus 3i. It's okay. The solution, if it's going to look like this, the solution is going to look, how can you tell me how the solution look like, guys, based on this? Help me, please. E to the power minus t, is that right? E to the power alpha t, this is alpha.
Sine
3t. Okay. Does it sound reasonable?
Yeah.
So how do I determine C1 and C2? X0 equal to minus 2. Zero here. Zero here. So C1 equal to minus 2. Is that right? Now what is x prime? X prime is going to be a little bit ugly because of the chain of the product rule. So it will be negative e to the power negative t let me know if we have a mistake, okay? And then plus e to the power minus t, and then differentiate this guy to be negative c1, negative 3c1 sine 3t plus 3c2 cosine 3t. So x prime 0 equal to 0 will give, what will it give? It will give 0 is equal to the sines are going to be gone, the cosines are going to be there. So it's C1 negative C1. Is it okay? Do I, can you guys make sure I didn't make any mistake?
That's what I'm asking.
Looks fine, right? So C1 is negative 2. Okay, so 0 equal to 2 plus 3C2. C2 is equal to minus 2 over 3. So the solution look like this. Xt equal to e to the power minus t c1. C1 is minus 2 cosine 3t minus 2 over 3 sine 3t. But this guy here can be written as one single sinusoid. Okay? A times sine 3t plus the phase shift. What is A? You guys know how to compute A? A is the square root of minus 2 squared plus minus 2 over 3 squared. Let me know if I make a mistake. Okay, 4 plus 4 over 9 will be square root of 17 over... Is it? No, not 17. Square root of 40 over 3. Is that right? I think it looks right. At some angle. What is that angle? How do I find that angle? This minus 2, this minus 2 is actually equal to a sine 5 minus 2 over 3 is a cosine 5. So 5 will be equal to arctangent of tangent of the sine of over cosine is tangent. This guy over this guy. Tangent inverse of 3. 2 over this. This guy over this guy. Are you guys following me?
I'm a little bit confused on why that, how you set up those equations. Negative 2 is equal to a sine 3.
What you hear?
You know, the top or the mid, this left, one? The one to two above that, yeah.
How about this top bottom part? Is this bottom part okay?
Yeah, I think you proved this last time, right?
Yeah. A is this guy square plus this guy square, and then the square root would be A. Okay, so this guy also is A sine theta phi. This other one is A cosine phi. Because of the trig identity, sine, cosine, cosine, sine.
Okay.
And that's why you end up with this. So this phi is going to be, now sine over cosine, this guy over this guy will give you tangent, right? So tangent inverse of the ratio of these two guys is going to be 3, the two cancel, all right. The two over the top. But you have to adjust it a little bit because this guy is in what quadrant? Sine is negative and cosine is negative is
quadrant 3
will be 3, but this guy, the calculator is going to give you quadrant 1, so you have to add pi. Is it okay?
Yeah.
So can you guys tell me what is arctangent of 3 in radian? Can someone help me? Arctangent of 3 in radian, and then you add pi to it.
I'm getting 1.249.
Add the 3, it's 4.39. 4.4.
1 pawn. Okay, add pi will be what?
4.39.
So that is in radian, right? So that is the equation. Okay. okay? Now let's try to roughly grab this. I'm gonna roughly grab this, okay? I'm gonna do it by hand. Get an idea. What's going on here? Sine 3t. Sine looks like this, sine 3t. Usually sine looks like this, right? The 3t is just compressing it. The 3t is just compressing it. But then this guy is gonna be, this is, going to shift to the right or to the left? Is it shifting to the right or to the left? You have a plus.
Right.
You guys know what I'm talking about? When you add this to T, does it shift it to the right or to the left, the curve? You guys don't remember your pre-calculus? You replace T by T minus something.
And shift to the left, right?
Huh?
Left.
If right. Shifting to the left. Okay. To be more exact, you should think about it this way. If you want to really grab it. About this, okay? So it shifts to the left. So this one is already compressed, okay? So this period here, this period is not going to be 2 pi anymore. From here to here is 2 pi over 3, because this 3 here, that 3 there will compress it, okay? And then you shift to the left by 1.46, somewhere here, 1.46, okay? Now, but this guy is also have this thing at the front. So the amplitude, actually, the actual amplitude of this graph actually just keep shrinking. Can you guys see what I'm talking about? Keep shrinking. So you actually end up with something like this. It's probably something like this. It's something like this. You guys know what I'm talking about? I'm going to erase the original one. And this is the thing here. Yeah. This is little pi minus two. Is it kind of all right? You guys understand why this curve look roughly like this? Yes, no, maybe. So it's this sinusoid, but it's the angular speed is 3. There's a shift, horizontal shift. The shift is to the right, okay? And then, but the amplitude here, this whole this is the entire amplitude, right? Sorry, I probably should have. The amplitude is essentially kind of this one. It's a kind of a pseudo amplitude because this one is not this amplitude, but modulated by e to the power minus t. E to the power minus t looks like that. So the curve, instead of keep bouncing around, okay, with the same amplitude, it's actually just the amplitude is sliding down. Because of this exponential decay. Okay, so I'll just let you think about it and ask me. Does it somewhat make sense? Does not make sense?
Oh, yeah, it makes sense.
Jenna?
Oh, sorry.
Could you just repeat it once more?
Okay, so this one here, you have a sine function. Okay. This 3 is the angular speed. Okay. The 1.46 is that you shift it to the left. It's a basically a phase shift, right? A horizontal shift. Okay. Now, so usually when you think about sine functions, it looks like this, right? Let's say something like this, you understand the amplitude is always 3. Mm-hmm. Then you will just, in this case, it will just go like this, right?
Right.
But here, the amplitude is not just the square root 4t over 3. It has the e to the power minus t in front. So essentially, it's this guy, but then it's just, when t equals to 0, this is the height. This is the amplitude. But the amplitude keeps going down because of this e to the power minus t at the front. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's this guy. That's why it bounces like that.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Is it okay with other people? Are you guys okay with this picture? So eventually, what happened with time goes to infinity? What do you think happened with t equal to time goes to infinity?
Goes to zero?
It's going to go to zero. This guy is going to keep tapering off. Okay? Eventually it died down, but it bounces around a lot. It keeps bouncing. Because this is underdamped. The damping coefficient is not big enough. So unlike the case that we talked about 2 days ago, the overdamped and critically damped, it doesn't really bounce much. It bounces across the t-axis at most once. Okay, xt equal to 0 at most once. And here it's going to go to 0 infinite number of times. But the amplitude getting smaller and smaller. Okay, this is the underdamped case. Is it okay? You guys okay? Any question? You guys are very quiet, so you guys lost?
Right now I'm just trying to take it in. It's a little,
okay,
a little confusing, but I guess like the more you break it down, the more it makes sense.
Okay.
I'm just gonna make like little cards,
probably. Okay. I'm gonna just write down the general case then, okay, with the lambda and the omega. But it's basically similar to this example. Okay.
So what does it say on the number 3? At the very top, you see lambda squared minus omega squared less than 0 is what?
Under them.
Under them. Sorry, it's...
No, that's fine. I just said I'm trying to keep using this marker, which is
probably... You're good.
I'm supposed to throw it away by now.
Do you mind using like the darker marker? Yeah, because the red is a little hard to make out.
Yeah, the problem is that I have a whole box of red. That's why I'm trying to.
That one's better. That one's really good.
That's fine.
Yeah, that's
throw it away earlier rather than later. Red is difficult to see.
Yeah.
But we run out of everything at the office. The day when we shut down, I just throw a whole box of red. That's okay. I'll probably throw it away sooner rather than later. Because it doesn't work well after a while.
Yeah, because the red kind of looks like it has like a hue around it, so it makes
it's kind of difficult.
Overexposed. Yeah.
I can probably still use it, but just once it's, yeah. I mean, at the beginning it works for a little while.
You're good.
Yeah, but after a while it doesn't work well. Okay, so this is the case, okay? So in this case, I mean, I'm going to just focus in on this case now, but doing this with symbol, okay? So M will be minus, okay, so what was the equation? The equation is... dx squared, d squared x dt squared plus 2 lambda dx dt plus omega 6, right? Is that right? I think that's right. I think that's what I had before. Yes. Okay. So characteristic equation will be, so m will be minus this guy plus or minus square root. Now, because with this condition, okay, so here, b square minus 4ac, this guy square minus 4, this all the way over 2. So this guy will minus 2 lambda plus or minus square root of lambda square minus 1 with the square. I put the 2 at the front. Can I just do this? I kind of simply, do you know what I just did? I took the 4 out and then become 2, and then I get rid of the 1 at the bottom. Is it okay? We have seen this expression a couple of days ago. Now, but this guy is less than 0, so we will have an I there. So this one will be minus lambda plus or minus square root omega square minus lambda square I. Is it okay? Do you guys follow this? It's a bunch of symbols. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So the solution is going to be xt equal to e to the power minus lambda t c1 cosine this guy t plus c2 sine this guy t, right? It's okay. And then based on the initial condition, you determine C1 and C2. And then this eventually become A times some amplitude, which is, I'm gonna write down what A is. A is gonna be C1 squared plus C2 squared, and then square root, A times sine. Sine this guy. And what is phi? Phi is tangent inverse C1 over C2, or tangent inverse C1 over C2 plus phi. Okay, so eventually it looks like this. I forgot a T here. Okay. And the graph will look like what we said earlier. Okay, will be something like this. Okay. Okay. That's okay. How are we doing now?
Could you stand a little bit more to the right or left? Okay, thank you. It's a little hard to see.
This side. Are you guys good?
Can we just have some time to copy down what's on the board?
Okay. This is basically capturing what that, what we just did with the actual numbers.
I'm sorry, I'm missing something. I didn't catch where you got cosine and sine from.
You mean this guy and this guy?
Yeah, I didn't, I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
Oh, because this guy is, because of this. Because of this. Okay. Alpha plus or minus beta I. Okay. Will be e to the power alpha t cosine beta t. Sine beta t. You know what I'm talking about, Antonio?
I'd have to go back, but probably.
Do you understand what we did on the example, the one I did before this?
I'm still looking at it, so.
That is exactly what happened. In that example, we have what? We have minus one plus or minus. We have minus one plus or minus.
Oh, Megan says it's the Euler's relation thing. Is that what you're getting at?
Yeah, it's the other one, we have minus one plus or minus three I, right?
Okay.
So it's e to the power minus t cosine three t. The other one is e to the power minus t sine three t.
Oh, okay. I think
so I understand. That.
I think I understand.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's coming from, okay. Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Is it okay?
No, I don't worry about it yet. Just not yet.
Okay, I was just going to erase this part in black.
Okay, I'm good.
I'm not erasing the whole thing yet. So, any other question, guys? Because I'm going to go to the next one, which is in some sense even more crazy.
Can we compare the graph of this one with the previous example? Which was just
the one I just did earlier today.
Yeah.
I mean, this one is the same as that. I mean, this one are just symbols.
It's just all right. Got it.
I mean, I can't really draw it until I know what lambda and omega.
Yeah, got it. I see.
Okay.
Yeah, I got it.
The one that we just did was certain value of lambda.
Yeah, we can just say that the previous one was a negative one.
Similar to the previous. Yeah. I mean, the details of where it starts, I mean, the phase shift.
No, I understand. Yeah. I got it. Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. We are going to do the next one. Different motion. Okay. So in this example, in this type of example here, essentially what happened is that this other side has something in it. Okay. The other side has a function. So if you look about the spring's mass system look like this. This spring is hanging from somewhere. You should think one way to think about it is that this is actually your hand. Okay? I don't know how to draw a hand. Five fingers or something. I don't know. This is a hand for me. Okay, you have your hand there. And then you move your hand. Okay. You guys know what I'm talking about? When you move your hand,
yeah.
Then it will induce a force. Okay, on the whole system. You guys know what I'm trying to say. So basically,
you're is hoping, it always the case?
Okay. Hoping, there are other scenario. there are other scenario to make it look, to realize this equation. But at least that's one way to think about it. Okay. So basically, you can think about the support that's moving. So there, you can have other scenario which will be essentially doing this. But basically, what we are saying is that there is a external force, okay, acting on the system. Okay, something similar to this will be like a bridge. You have a bridge. The bridge has. You can model the bridge similar to this. The bridge can vibrate, right? I mean, you have people walking on it, that will be the external force. Otherwise, the bridge has a natural frequency, which is this guy, which is omega. Okay, that's why people say that, you probably know that the bridge, if everybody marches on the big bridge with the same natural frequency of the bridge will collapse. And that's resonance. Have you heard about that?
Yeah.
So that is when you have a sign, so you have something with a frequency which is similar to, which is the same as this frequency, and the bridge will swing more and more. Okay. But I mean, if you don't, this one is not, it's not the same frequency as this, then you don't have much of a problem. Okay. So that's why when you walk across the bridge, they ask you to just like, you don't want to march across the bridge. Okay. With everybody in sync. And if it happened to be the natural frequency of the bridge, then the bridge will just vibrate more and more. Okay, and that's resonance. It's just like when you push a swing, if you push a swing, usually the way you do this is that every time you push it in a way so that the kid sitting on the swing will swing higher and higher, right? And because you try to push it at the correct time, and that time is basically you push it, how often you push it? Once every period of the natural period of that pendulum. Okay, and that's why the child gets higher and higher. So if you want to stop the kid, then you don't push it, you don't want to push it in sync, then the thing will stop. Okay, so we have another function here on the other side. So this guy is not going to be homogeneous anymore. I am going to do an example with numbers first, okay? So we'll do this example. So this marker is a lot better, right?
Yes, sir.
So the mass is 1/5 unit, 1/5 unit. There's a damping constant of 1.2, spring constant is 2, okay? So how do I put this into this form? So we have to get rid of the 1/5. So you divide by 1/5. Then you end up with this. Are you guys with me?
Yeah.
Yep.
Someone asked if this is still for underdamped, or is this a different case?
You can figure out whether it's under dam or not. Can you see whether it's under dam or not by looking at these coefficients? B squared minus 4ac. What do you think?
One lambda.
M squared plus 6m plus 10 equal to 0, right? So we first have to solve the part where this guy is equal to 0, right? The right-hand side equal to 0. And then we have to do the particular solution thing. You guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
So M will be 1. Now this will answer your question. There are two ways to answer your question. One is to just go ahead and do this. which is minus 6 plus or minus square root 36 minus 40 over 2. So which case is it? Is this complex or real? Complex. Complex is which case?
Under damp.
Another way to look at that, of course, another way to look at that, this one is 2 lambda. So lambda is equal to 3. Omega is equal to what? Square root 10. And then you will see which one is bigger. Lambda square is 9. This guy square is 10. So 9 is less than 10. So it's this one. Is it okay?
Yeah.
It's probably easier to do it directly from the equation anyway, from the auxiliary, from the characteristic equation. So this one will be what? Minus 3 plus or minus? Minus 4, right? Plus or minus 9? I skip some steps. 36 minus 40 is negative 4, take the 4 out. Square root 4 is equal to 2, 2 and 2 cancel.
Professor?
Yes.
So for F, that equation is just the hand, the equation of the force of the hand.
Which equation? This equation?
The 5 cosine 40 on the right side.
Yeah, it's a force induced by the hand movement.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the force induced by the hand movement. Yeah. It depends on how your hand moves. Okay. Because your hand move, when your hand moves, you are actually kind of either stretching or compressing the spring, and then the spring will react and that induces that force. Okay, so we have the complementary solution now. Okay, XC, complementary solution, is the solution to the homogeneous part of the equation. You guys remember all this stuff, right? From chapter 4. So XC is what? E to the power minus 3t. Is that right? C1 cosine t. Plus C2 sine t. Is it correct or not? Do I have initial condition here? Okay. Let me also write down the initial condition. I forgot to write down the initial condition. Okay. How are we doing? Do you guys understand how I get from here to here? It's the same as what Antonio asked me earlier. Right? Is that alpha plus beta I? Alpha plus or minus beta I? E to the power alpha t? Cosine beta t, sine beta t. Do I look for C1, C2 now or later? You cannot do it now. You have to do it later because you have to find XP first.
Oh, yeah.
You see what I'm saying? You have to do XP first. What does XP look like? You have to use method of undetermined coefficient or annihilator type stuff to find XP. Now you look at the right hand side, look like this. XP, what is the form of XP? Anybody know? Cosine. If you take derivative of cosine, you will get what? Sine on the negative sign, and sine will become cosine again. So there is a times something A what?
A sine plus B cosine.
Okay, something like this. Okay, I wrote in the opposite order as what you said, but that's kind of okay, I think. Either way, it's fine. It's okay?
Yeah.
And then you have to solve for A and B by plugging this into here. You guys know what I'm talking about? And the thing is so long, I'm going to just write down the answer. Is it okay? Because I don't want to go through too much stuff. Otherwise, we'll just spend all day doing calculation instead of talk about something more conceptual. And we have done this type of stuff before. You guys don't want to talk about, take this guy, take the derivative and the second derivative, plug it back into here, and then compare both sides. System of equations, two equations, two unknown in A and B.
Yeah.
Other people okay? Yeah.
Could you repeat how you got XP?
XP by looking at the form of this section 4.4 stuff. You take this guy cosine 40. Cosine 40, you differentiate, you get minus sine 40, minus 4. So constant doesn't matter much. Cosine, minus sine, sine, cosine. So those are the two potential functions. Those are the two that you need to, this is a base, form the basis. Okay, these are the form a basis for this candidate. So this is a candidate for XP, and you have to determine A and B. Okay, that's what 4.4 say, section 4.4. Is it okay, Talia?
Thank you, yeah.
And then you put this XP into here, okay? And then set it equal to the right-hand side. The right-hand side means that the non-zero one. Non-zero. Okay, so I end up with these two values of A and B. It turns out to be, this is really ugly. A equal to minus 25 over 102. P is equal to 50 over 51. Okay? So this is my XP now. Minus 25, 102. Cosine 40 plus B, B is 1, 50 over 51, sine 40, okay? That's my XP. So what is my answer? My answer x of t will be xc plus xp, right? Which is this dot here. C1 cosine t plus c2 sine t minus 25 over 102. Cosine 40 plus this guy sine 40. Okay, now is the time to determine C1 and C2 using the initial condition. X use initial condition. X0 equal to 1/2, x prime 0 equal to 0. I mean, this is a lot of work. You still have to differentiate this whole chunk of stuff, set it to 0 and all this stuff. But I am not going to go through that. I am going to just tell you what C1 and C2 is. Okay.
Sorry, how did you get A and B again? Just really quick.
A and B?
Yeah.
I just talked through it. Okay, yeah. A and B, the way to get A and B is section 4.4. Take this guy, differentiate once, put it in here, differentiate again, put it in here, set it equal to the right-hand side, compare the coefficient of cosine 40 and sine 40.
Got it.
System of two equations and two unknown in A and B. Solve that system of two equations, two unknown, and you get A and B.
Okay, thank you.
Now here, using the initial condition, you plug it into this whole chunk of stuff, equal to 1/2, differentiate this whole thing, plug the zero in, set it to zero, then you get C1 equal to some number. 38/51, C2 minus 86/51. Okay. So at the end of the day, my answer is going to be this. Can I not write it, guys? I'm lazy. Can I just put it in here? It's C1 is 38/51. This C2 is minus 86/51. Okay. Any questions so far? Let's look at, are you guys okay? It's a lot, huh?
Quite a bit.
What did you say? Okay, you agree, okay. You ask questions, guys. If you have questions, just ask them.
We just found out that the spring semester is gonna be online. What does that mean for the final?
It's gonna be online.
What do you mean by is it gonna be online? Somebody is recording it, right?
An email just came out saying that the rest of the semester is going to be distance and online learning. So I think they're just asking about the final and its format.
Yeah, just kind of curious how the
I see, the email from the school?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense. I think they should do that. We have to figure it out. I mean, we'll see how well it works then. We'll see how well it works on the test. I mean, this stuff will be on 5.1 is on the test, Nick, when you come back. 5.1 is actually on the test when you come back.
5.1 and
starting from 4.3, I believe. Last time, where did we end?
I think so.
I'll send out whatever we did. We stopped last time, and then we will start on the section after that until 5.1 will be the next test. I don't know. It's really hard to do the test and the final. I don't know whether you guys have any good suggestion. The problem is that no matter what I do, I cannot stop cheating or collaborate.
Well, you can request the work that people do for each problem. I think on web design, you can upload the pictures of what they do. And I guess you can go based on that.
Well, I can't. How can I stop people from doing those pictures together?
What do you mean? That'll be their work, right?
I think he means collaboration.
Huh?
I think you're talking about collaboration. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to stop people collaborating.
Yeah. Oh, it's because it's open.
One possibility, I can just give some really hard questions so that even if you collaborate, it's difficult to do, but then the whole class will not do well.
Oh, no, that's fine. Don't worry about it.
That seems like a bad idea.
Shut up. Or give the time Okay, the time limit is so short. I mean, I'll give so many questions that you're running out of time.
But that doesn't work for everyone.
So it seems like a bad idea.
Yeah.
Okay. Some people work at a lower speed than others. So.
What is the time limit for this next test?
The next test, I'm thinking about 75 minutes.
How about 90?
Can 90? We negotiate?
90 is too long for that. I only have 5 questions. I mean,
well, 85. I mean, also too that the
oh, 90. There. So I already have 75. I mean, give you another 15 minutes. You're saying?
Yeah, I mean, it's 15 minutes.
Okay, I can do that. I don't
because especially since like it's not a regular exam because I mean the implication for me at least, the way I'm understanding is that obviously if the exam is open book and open note, then more is expected of the student because they have the resources. So the problems might be harder in comparison to what we normally get on a regular test in person.
Potentially, but it depends on how.
Please don't make it harder.
Yeah.
Oh no, of course, please don't make it harder.
I'm actually not making it harder.
Okay.
And the format will be kind of just like how our homework is set up currently.
The format is going to be essentially similar to what your homework is. The problem really is that the difficulty is, okay, my God, I shouldn't spend too much time on this. The difficulty is that I cannot stop people from
looking at
collaboration, right?
Right.
So, which...
Well, I mean, right now, we're all kind of stuck at home.
I mean, it's really hard, so.
Let's just try it for right now first and see what happens.
Yeah, okay, that's, on the one that you come back, we are going to just do what I just said. I mean, I'm going to give you 90 minutes and 5 problems.
Okay.
Oh, 5 problems?
I have the review sheet.
Review sheet, I will give you this again.
Okay, perfect. We're good.
Okay, so it's just very hard, very difficult to make it fair to everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just don't make it really hard, please.
Okay.
Because I'm more fair.
I don't think I will, but because that's what some UCs are doing. I mean, because I talked to some people, they say, oh, they just make the questions so the test so long that I mean you don't even have time to cheat. I mean basically so you have to keep working on it. So okay, let's at least try to finish this. Okay. So I didn't know that they sent out an email today. It just happened, right?
Yeah.
I think is the right thing to do because the chance we are going back is so small and people need to know in order to plan because some people are not local.
Yeah.
Okay. If you're not going to be doing anything face to face, people might as well, because they may be international students, they may want to go home.
Also, our classroom is really small. So to have, it was 25, 30 people in there? Not a good idea.
Yeah, the classrooms are also hotbed for, it's very small, so people crowd together. They never clean the classroom, it's so dirty.
I don't know why they were even thinking of reopening by then. This doesn't make any sense.
I was a couple of semesters ago, because at the front of the classroom, they always have all this kind of junk, right? Different professors put it there, or students forget a notebook and so on. There's a whole box of junk in one classroom. I try really hard to throw it away. I put it next to the garbage can, and what happened the next day?
Put it back.
The whole thing back onto the desk, onto my desk, with all the cobweb. Okay, they say that maybe I should. The janitor probably think that I shouldn't throw this away. This may be important. Put it back on my desk with all the cobweb and everything on it. So when I next semester in fall when I go back, I will physically take that outside of the classroom.
Take it and put it back
in the common area. Okay.
Just burn down the whole school. Okay. Just clean it.
So I mean, it's very difficult to throw away something. Okay. It was so frustrating. Okay. I should finish something at least. Okay, because we want to get to a stopping point before we run out of time. So I want to ask you this: what happened to this guy as he goes to infinity? What happened to that guy as it goes to infinity? Can you see this term as time goes to infinity? What happened?
It goes to zero again.
It goes to zero. Yes, because this is the part where you have this. You always, this part correspond to, in the general situation, okay, will correspond to this guy, right? Cosine omega squared minus lambda squared t, some constant. Right? And this part is going to go to zero. Okay, approach zero as t approach infinity. Okay? Because of the e to the power minus lambda t. So what is left? What is left? It's going to be this guy. Now this guy can be written as a sinusoid, right? This guy can be written as a sinusoid, which is a cosine 40 plus 5. Now this A is not this A, okay? These are two different A's, guys. Is it okay? Can I?
Okay.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Just make sure that you understand it's not the same A. All right, maybe I erase this A here and then nobody can tell. Okay. So basically, as time goes to infinity, eventually the graph of this guy, the graph is going to be driven by, it's essentially similar to the force, to this guy, the external force. You see what I'm saying? So your hand is doing this, getting this external thing here. So this guy, this was similar. So at the end of the day, the original natural frequency, the natural behavior intrinsic in the mass spring system, that one died down, is this guy died down, because that one looked like this, right? That one looked like this. That was the part. This is essentially the complementary solution, died down. And all you have is the graph. It's going to be the same as this graph, except with a different amplitude. Okay, with a different, doesn't have this A, is not 25 anymore. This A is the square, it's this guy square plus this guy square takes square root. And then with a phase difference. Is it kind of okay?
So as t goes to infinity, the sinusoid that's describing the particular solution is going to look more and more similar to the sinusoid that's describing the external force?
Yeah, essentially the complementary solution will be gone.
Right.
All you have is a particular solution. Yeah, some form of particular solution. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
And the particular solution is driven by this guy. Same frequency as this guy. That's what it said. Other questions, guys? I actually was originally planning to talk about resonance, but I don't think I will have enough time because it's a little bit long. So I don't think I will be able to fit it in with 9 minutes left. But the homework, you don't need that to do the homework, and you, so we can just skip that. The resonance is the following situation. Maybe I can just talk a little bit about it. Yeah, I'll talk a little bit about it. The resonance situation is something like this. me get an example here. They don't have an example here. I can make one up here. Okay, I'm gonna talk about resonance a little bit, okay? The resonance situation is really same as this, except I just get rid of the form. Okay, instead of 4t, I'll just have t. Okay, I'm gonna just hand wave through this whole thing. When you just have t, this xc is still the same, right? This part is still the same because this is just a solution for the homogeneous part. It's okay. But then the problem is that here, when you do xp, what happened? When you do xp, it's not going to be these two anymore. Okay, it's going to be somewhat different, guys, right? It's going to be somewhat different because do you remember that? Do you remember when you do the particular solution? When you do the particular solution, when it crashes with the complementary solution, what do you do? You guys remember that?
Multiply by x until they no longer look the same.
Multiply by x. So in this case, we'll multiply by t. It's okay. You multiply by t. Okay. So you eventually solve for c. You eventually solve for a and b. Get some answer for a and b. Put in the initial condition, solve for C1 and C2. So at the end of the day, you still have something like this, xc plus xp, okay? Where xc look like this, xp look like this. Now, what happened here is the following. What happened, of course, as time goes to infinity, limit, okay, as t go to infinity, so xc will still go to zero, right? Okay, but what happened to xp? Xp not just oscillate. It's not just oscillating, but there's a t there. Do you see this extra t? So this will be t times a cosine t plus b times sine t. Now this one is a sinusoid. The sinusoid times the t. That means the graph of that is going to look like this. The graph of that is look like this. You have this t here. Okay, this is t and this is x. Okay, so the sinusoid is going to look like this. You guys know what I'm talking about? And this extra t, which is green in color, this one, is the one which is the resonance. You remember you multiply by t to avoid the crashes between the particular and complementary solution, and that t is going to make this amplitude just keep going bigger and bigger.
So does that mean it keeps bouncing?
It keeps bouncing, but bouncing higher and higher.
Is the
amplitude
period?
Larger and larger? That's why the bridge collapsed.
Okay, got it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a good way to just give you a high overview of this.
Yeah.
Okay. But because here, this is cosine t, the external force give rise to a function which is the same frequency as the intrinsic frequency of your system. Okay. And that causes you to add an extra t here to avoid the crashes between the xc and xp. And that extra t is going to cause this amplitude to keep going up. And that's resonance.
Thank you.
No problem. Okay, so anything else? There are no classes next week. I will send out a study guide this coming weekend. And the test will have 5 problems. It will be on web assigned. Okay.
I know.
3 tries per problem, 3 tries per answer. Are we good?
Yes.
So for, I was going to ask, so for each question, I forget how exactly it works. During the exam, will it tell us like each one as we enter them that we got incorrect, or do we
have to give you feedback? If you enter it and it's wrong, it will tell you, then you will try it again.
No, but I mean, like, we don't have to submit the whole exam to find out if we got certain numbers wrong, correct? Because that's how sometimes.
No, I don't think so. Okay. I don't think so.
Okay, just because that's how it works in Canada sometimes.
Yeah, I don't think so. Any other thing, guys? Okay, just stay safe, okay? Don't go out unless you have to buy grocery.
Can I ask how you found lambda and omega, the part you circled in red for the middle of the board?
Yeah, that's fine. Because we have this thing, it's really from here. 2 lambda is equal to 6. This is 2 lambda.
Okay.
2 lambda is 6. This is omega squared. It's okay?
Yes, thank you.
No problem. Anything else? Is it a lot today?
Kind.
A little bit.
Okay.
But I think once we do the homework, it will get easier.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so when we come back on Tuesday, not next Tuesday, the week after. I don't know, I mean, we can go to chapter 6 or we can do a little bit review, it's up to you guys, okay? And then we have a test on Thursday.
Thursdays are gonna be open at specific time, the usual time or?
Usual time, 12:45, and I'll give you 90 minutes.
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to start at 12:45, correct? We can't, like, it's not like a window of do it in within this amount of hours or whatever.
Yeah, you have to start at that time.
Okay.
Yeah, you have to start at that time.
Okay.
Professor?
Yeah.
Somebody just asked if they have questions, is email the best way to reach you?
You mean during the break?
Yeah, during the break.
After the break, I mean, you can do email or, I mean, I actually hold office hour. But you guys, as I said, you should send me an email telling me that you are coming. So I have office hour Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, starting 2:30 to 3:30. So if you just drop me an email saying that I plan to come to your office hour, okay, at 2:30 on that certain day, let's say Wednesday, the day before the test, then I'll just be there. Does that answer the question for the person?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, some students don't have the microphone, right? And I don't check on the chat that much.
It looks like
you don't want to.
I don't want to. Because you're talking behind my back or something?
No.
My last time saying that, I get dragged to quarantine.
That was only Antonio.
That's only Antonio. Okay.
I did not say that. That would be Kevin.
Okay. Yeah, you can send me, you can come to the office hour. And even during the
break. You should hear what Kevin says about you.
You can send me. You can send me email during the break if you want, okay? Just send it to my school email. If you send it to the campus email, I don't check it, okay? Don't worry, Antonio, I'm just kidding, okay? Don't worry. I know you are kidding, so no problem.
I'm gonna get you, Kevin, and I'll make it look like an accident.
That's all right. Don't worry about it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, anything else?
Cool.
All right, so we'll end the meeting. Okay, stay safe.
Thank you, Professor. Have a good break.
Thank you, Professor.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye bye.
Thank you, Professor. Bye. Pong, Lot 7, Kenyatta.
You're the best.
Okay, bye.